Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing Your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the
and welcome to our service today. My name is Claire Corley and I'm the new vicar here at Wortley and Farnley. It's good to see you. I hope you're having a good week. Sometimes people ask me to summarise what it means to follow Christ, and I talk about His forgiveness, His acceptance, His presence through me through the Holy Spirit. I talk about church and community and friendship. I talk about awe and transcendency. But I also talk about what He calls me into. In our confession today, we're going to end with some verses from the book of Micah in the Old Testament, where He calls us to do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. I love those words. The call to live a life seeking justice, loving mercy, and walking with the God who knows and loves me is something I don't always get right. But it is an adventure. It's something that captivates me, that I'm eager to sign up for every day. So today, this morning, let's bring what's ever on our mind to the God who loves us, forgives us, and calls us into a life led with him, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, who was in the beginning, is now, and shall be forever. Amen. May the grace and mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you. This is the day that the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it. Our first hymn today is All for Jesus. The night has passed, and the day lies open before us. Let us pray with one heart and mind. As we rejoice in the gift of this day, so may the light of your presence, O God, set our hearts on fire with love for you, now and forever. Amen. We move this morning into something called our confession, an opportunity for us to bring to God, to bring into the light, as it were, those things that we're ashamed of or wish we hadn't done. And it's also a chance for us to come collectively before God as a church community and as our nation and our world. For God so loved the world that he gave his one Son, Jesus Christ, to save us from our sins, to be our advocate in heaven, and to bring us to eternal life. So if you'd like to join with us this morning, we say together, Most merciful God, Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, we confess that we have sinned in thought, word, and deed. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbours as ourselves. In your mercy, forgive what we have been. Help us to amend what we are and direct what we shall be, that we may do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with you, our God. Amen. May the Father of all mercies cleanse us from our sins and restore us in his image, to the praise and glory of his name, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. We're going to have our first reading now, which is from the book of Romans, chapter 8, verses 1 to 11, and it's read today by Sue.
There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. For the law of Spirit of life in Jesus Christ has set you free from the law of sin and of death. For God has done what the law, weakened by the flesh, could not do, by sending his own Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, and to deal with sin, he condemned sin in the flesh, so that the just requirement of the law might be fulfilled in us, who walk not according to the flesh, but according to the Spirit. For those who live according to the flesh set their minds on the things of the flesh, but those who live according to the Spirit set their minds on things of the Spirit. To set the mind on the flesh is death, but to set the mind on the Spirit is life and peace. For this reason, the mind that is set on the flesh is hostile to God. It does not submit to God's law. Indeed, it cannot. And those who are in the flesh cannot please God. But you are not in the flesh, you are in the Spirit, since the Spirit of God dwells in you. Anyone who does not have the Spirit of Christ does not belong to him. But if Christ is in you, though the body is dead because of sin, the Spirit is life because of righteousness. If the Spirit of him who raised Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he who raised Christ from the dead will give life to your mortal bodies also through his Spirit that dwells in you. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Our second reading today is from Matthew chapter 13, verses 24 to 30. Then it skips across to verses 36 to 43. And it's read today by Margaret.
He put before them another parable. The kingdom of heaven may be compared to someone who sowed good seed in his field. But while everybody was asleep, an enemy came and sowed weeds among the wheat and then went away. So when the plants came up and bore grain, then the weeds appeared as well. And the slaves of the householder came and said to him, "Master, did you not sow good seed in your field? Where then did these weeds come from?" He answered, "An enemy has done this." The slaves said to him, "Then do you want us to go and gather them?" But he replied, "No, for in gathering the weeds, you would uproot the wheat along with them. Let both of them grow together until the harvest. And at harvest time, I will tell the reapers, 'Collect the weeds first and bind them in bundles to be burned, but gather the wheat into my barn.'" Then he left the crowds and went into the house. And his disciples approached him, saying, "Explain to us the parable of the weeds of the field." He answered, "The one who sows the good seed is the Son of Man. The field is the world, and the good seed are the children of the kingdom. The weeds are the children of the evil one, and the enemy who sowed them is the devil. The harvest is the end of the age, and the reapers are angels. Just as the weeds are collected and burned up with the fire, so it will be at the end of the age. The Son of Man will send his angels, and they will collect out of his kingdom all causes of sin and all evildoers. And they will throw them into the furnace of fire, where there will be weeping and gnashing of teeth. Then the righteous will shine like the sun in the kingdom of their Father. Let anyone with ears listen." This is the gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ.
Thanks, Margaret. Now, I wrote this sermon on Wednesday morning, and as I was waking up, I do what I normally do, and I'm browsing my Twitter feed. And J.K. Rowling was once again making the headlines. She signed a letter, along with another 150 signatories, calling for the end of the so-called cancel culture. It's a bit of a new term, this. I don't know if you've heard what it is. Obama referred to it a little bit too in a now widely shared clip about woke culture. But cancel culture basically refers to the online shaming of individuals who cause offence. If somebody says something that somebody else feels is wrong or acts in a way that others perceive as bad, they risk being shamed or called out by those online. Now, with all things in life, this is really complex. Some claim that it enables them to hold people to account that they otherwise might not be able to. And that's one of the joys of social media, is you've got a much bigger audience than you would do otherwise. Others claim that actually it's stopping freedom of speech. It's a modern form of a witch hunt. It's some type of mob rule. Now, I'm not going to go into that now, and I'll let you do your research and work out where you land. As ever, there's probably a good dose of both views in there. But it does me ask the question, what's the Christian response to this? Where do Christians stand with wrongdoing? Well, Paul's quite clear about this. He says in that opening verse of Romans, there is no condemnation for those who are in Jesus Christ. Isn't that thrilling? It's the greatest statement of liberation and freedom ever known to humankind. The knowledge that I have and that I will make mistakes, yet that in Christ I will be forgiven, held firm in his love and nurture, not disbanded, not cancelled, not pushed out, but nurtured, equipped, emboldened to step forward again and again, is a truth that transformed my life as a teenager. And it's a truth that continues to transform my life today. So in Christ, we don't find this so-called cancel culture where one mistake means you're out. The fear that one wrong word or one badly judged action will call us to be ostracized or pushed out, ignored or written off. In Christ, the very opposite happens. Regardless of how worthy we do or do not feel, Christ does not condemn us, but calls us by name and calls us to live and work as part of his family and calls us to offer that grace to those we meet. Well, so far, so good. But does that imply that we can never hold people to account, that we can just do what we want and people are going to have to live with it? Does that mean that we can see things in the past and say, well, it was okay then, but you know what? I really don't think that's okay now. You see, I don't think that is what Paul is saying here in Romans. For he says that that freedom we have in Christ, the fact that we don't live under condemnation, is offered freely, but can only be realised if we reorientate ourselves back to Christ. It's there in verse 5. Paul warns us that if we keep our minds on those things of the flesh, those things that hold us captive to greed or self-interest or selfishness, then we're simply killing ourselves. We're deadening the life, the beauty, the joy that could be within us. And instead, we're replacing it with something that offers short-term satisfaction, but in the long term does nothing but harm us. And that goes for ourselves individually and for ourselves as a community and as a society. But Paul warns you, standing in the freedom of Christ means that we're standing there to realise the full potential of who we are. We need to set our mind on the Spirit that gives us life, that gives us hope, that allows us to reset, to relearn. That means that when we get things wrong, we can try and put things right, that urges us to achieve our potential, that enables us to become wiser day by day, to become more empathetic day by day, to see a bigger picture day by day. Each day we're 1 degree more transformed into glory, 1 degree more made into the person who Christ made us to be. Okay. So we're free from condemnation. We can live in the freedom of Christ. With that comes a call to stand in his spirit of freedom and joy, to make changes to our lives, to put away those things that hold us back. Okay. But life is complex, isn't it? There's some of us who are living with pain that others have caused us. Whether that pain was caused deliberately or not, we human beings have an uncanny knack of wounding others, sometimes deliberately and sometimes without realizing it. Now, as Christians, we are called to forgive those who have wounded us, just as Christ has forgiven us. But that isn't to say that forgiveness is cheap or that forgiveness is easy. For some of us, that might be really complex, and it might actually take significant time. It might also include setting boundaries or limits on how we interact with that person. God doesn't ask us to put ourselves in danger. But what he does call us to do with him, with him alongside us every step of the way, is to start that process of forgiveness so that we too can live unburdened in the light and hope of a new life with Christ, not one that is haunted or trapped by the shadows of the past, but one that is full of potential, realization and hope. Today, let us hear that we are not condemned. Whatever it is that holds you captive, we are not cancelled or written out. But we are called to amend our lives, to face the right direction, in order for us to fully know life, to fully be the wonderful humans that God has created. Let us pray. Father, we thank you that through the life, death, and resurrection of Christ, we are not condemned. We pray now, Father, that those things that hold us captive, you will release us from. And we pray that you will send your Spirit to renew within us a right heart, to rewire our minds, open our eyes, unblock our ears, that we may love you more dearly and follow you more nearly every night and day of our lives. Amen.
Giving glory to our Saviour Jesus. We sing Majesty.
Majesty. Worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be glory, honor, and praise. And majesty, kingdom, authority, from his throne unto his all his anthem raise. So exalted, so exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus who died, now glorify King of all kings.
We sing majesty. We're singing majesty. Worship his majesty. Unto Jesus be glory, honor, and praise. Oh, singing majesty, kingdom authority, flow from his throne. Unto his own, his anthem reign. So exalted, so exalted, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. And majesty, worship his majesty. Jesus, you died, now glorify, King of all. The Lord of lords, sing exalt, so exalt, lift up on high the name of Jesus. Magnify, come glorify Christ Jesus the King. Worship his majesty. Jesus, you died, now glorify, King of all kings. Jesus, you died, now
glorify. We join together now in our creed, which Christians over the centuries have attempted to say in a nutshell, as it is what we believe. If you're new to a journey of faith, there might be things in the creed that you're like, oh, I'm not sure about that. So please do join in where you are able. And actually, for some of us, we can use it as a prayer of where we would like to be and just reflect on the words and what they actually mean in our lives. But if you're able, please do join in this morning with our creed. We say together, I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. The third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. We're going to move now into our prayers of intercession.
Lord, you are a gracious guide. Hear us as we pray for the church in these times of uncertainty, as churches everywhere seek to reopen safely. Grant them patience. Grant them wisdom. And grant them the resources to open safely. We appeal to you, the good provider, who blesses us with all we need to do faithfully to you. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Lord, as many of us feel weary, you are the one who refreshes our souls. Hear us as we pray for leaders everywhere. World leaders, community leaders, political leaders, church leaders. Protect them. Guide them. Unite them. Grant us unity so we might walk together in mind and thought. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. And in this moment of quiet, Lord, we bring to you those who have asked for our prayers and those known to us who are struggling. Grant them love and support. Grant them health and safety. Grant us humility. Grant us courage. Grant us patience with one another. Grant us refreshment. Renew our hearts and souls. Lord, you are a gracious guide. Show us the paths you have prepared to teach us to walk in your way. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. In your love, you unite us. In your joy, you choose us to go out and bear fruit. In your power, you send us to be your faithful witness. Merciful Father, accept these prayers for the sake of your Son, our Saviour, Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
And staying in an attitude of prayer, we move to our collect, our special prayer of the day. Almighty and everlasting God, by whose Spirit the whole body of the Church is governed and sanctified, hear our prayer, which we offer for all your faithful people, that in their vocation and ministry they may serve you in holiness and truth to the glory of your name, through our Lord and Saviour Jesus Christ, who is alive and reigns with you in the unity of the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. And we move now into the Lord's Prayer. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. And our notices this morning. Our church building is still shut. We are planning and beavering away in the background about opening it up. But meanwhile, our online church is very much active. So do join us every evening at 7 p.m. for some contemplative prayers and music. Don't forget midweek. We have our midweek service on a Wednesday. That streams from 10 a.m. You can, of course, catch up whenever it's convenient. But it's a great way just midweek to pause, take stock and put all those tasks and jobs in perspective as we seek in our working week to love and serve God as much as we do on a Wednesday. A reminder too about the parish giving scheme. If you're willing to support the life and the work of the church on a monthly basis, please do have a look at information online or get in touch with Wendy to set that up. It makes such a difference and it means we can claim gift aid on all that you give. Reminder, we have a YouTube server, YouTube as well. Search for Wortley and Farnley Parish. Please do subscribe to that, totally free. Just gives us a bit of kudos. That'd be great. Messy church. We launched it last week. It happened again yesterday at 4 p.m. and it's going to go out again today at 3 p.m. If you know anyone who would appreciate that, please do signpost them to it. Full of activities, Bible stories, prayer and a song. For those of you that like a slightly calmer outlook on faith, we have a Teze service. That's happening on July the 26th at 7:30, so please do join in with that. And of course, after this service today, we've got our virtual coffee. Just message us, we'll send you a link. You don't have to be massively talkative. You can just sit there and laugh at everybody else. Great way to get to know each other. You can stay for a couple of minutes or for a full half an hour. It's up to you. But please do be brave and join us for that. It's gone really well over the last few weeks. It's just lovely to see faces to the names. And always, of course, if you are thinking and praying and you have something that you'd like to add in the mix, please do get in touch. If you know someone that's struggling and needs some prayer, again, please do get in touch with us as well. The more ideas that we have, the better. So we end our service this morning with our hymn, In Christ Alone.
My light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe, this gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save.
The precious blood of Christ.
We're now coming to the end of our service this morning, but before we go, let me pray for us as we go out this week to live and work to God's praise and glory. May the love of the Lord Jesus draw you to himself. May the power of the Lord Jesus strengthen you in his service. And the joy of the Lord Jesus fill your hearts. And may the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen. Take care, stay safe, and I'll see you next week, if not before.
Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. Worship his holy name. Sing like never before, oh my soul. I worship your holy name. The sun comes up. It's a new day dawning. It's time to sing your song again. Whatever may pass and whatever lies before me, let me be singing when the evening comes. Bless the Lord. Sing your praise unending.